I'll just say a few words and then show your profile to students and then hand it over. Yeah.
Sure.
And I'll be there. Okay. So, okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. And we want to thank Mr. Aman Mehra, who is the director now of Tribe from Pune, all the way joining from Pune in Maharashtra.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mr. Aman. And we're proud of you as an alumni. And I'm so proud as my former student, you know, doing a great work. So with your permission, what I'll do, I'll just share to the audience your a little profile on the LinkedIn, and already students, they know. So Harshit and students, can somebody unmute and tell me, are you able to see the LinkedIn page of Mr. Aman Mehra?
Yes, sir.
We are yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, perfect. Thanks. Okay, now I'll just quickly take you down through the education qualification so that you understand what Mr. Aman has studied. You can see there 2009 and 13, that is where I was in Vellore. Aman did his BTech Computer Science, and not just with just 7.75 CGPA, he was in so many things. He was in Toastmasters. He used to do a lot of events and a lot of programs and amazing active student. Yeah. And then immediately he went on to do his master's in University of Warwick, where he did his e-business management studies. And what I still remember about Aman and the whole team, they used to be, you know, totally with activities and all that. He also worked as an intern in Suzlon. I know he used to do a lot of digital marketing things and, whatever. Yeah. And you see then how he started his own startup journey. You can go through, I'll give you his LinkedIn, I'll give you his Facebook, I'll give you his Instagram. Okay. The reason is you, all right, are a student of VIT. Aman also was a student of us, you know, back then. And when he joined in 2009, little did he know that today he'll be a amazing, you know, founder. I'll tell you about the story behind the story. And guys, are you able to see the Instagram page of Aman? Yes, no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you'll be shocked to see.
Oh, God.
right, that's his page. And recently, I think so he went to Himachal, Manali. He is a guy with life full of fun. And I think so that's his whole team, if I'm not wrong, Tribe. Yeah, bro?
Yeah, that's my deal.
That's a whole team which he has developed. And I want to go down to his memory lane and just show you two pics. One of his graduation in VIT and one of his graduation in the University of Warwick, so that you understand that even you guys will one day graduate and have the topi and all that photo and fun. You will see how active Aman is. You know, his life is full of fun, but not at the cost of job, not at the cost of hard work, not at the cost of fun, you know. And that's one thing which really I liked in Aman, getting awards, all right, getting, you can go through his Instagram page. He was with Toastmasters International, which we are again now this year, I'm launching it here. And I think so, I need to go a little down there. Yesterday, I forgot to take it out and keep it.
Oh, God.
These are all your, I'll get back to your gang. Where is that? I think so. It's down.
All the way down.
Oh yeah, here you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Your
whole
VIT badge. Yeah. Mm. And but good that you take time for your, you know, personal.
You need it. Otherwise, you just burn. You burn out.
Yeah. So maybe what I'll do is I'll by the time you finish your talk.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's it. That's where you go. Your entire batch. I remember this whole gang of VIT. And it's fun, yeah. It's like you guys have really, you've done a lot of work. This is where your this is your convocation, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, this was
this is the VIT graduation in 2013, right?
Yes.
And you also have a pic with you and your mom and dad when you graduated there in Warwick. Yeah.
Yes,
and then you visited countries and all that. So anyway, I'll stop sharing the screen. The reason I wanted students to understand is, you know, a student who is so passionate, he was more into the learning space than the studying space.
True.
So proud, Aman, of you. And I remembered those days. I still remember we used to come and crib about, sorry, hostel kya hai, nothing is good, this is not good. And we used to always say, you find your own solutions. Yeah.
Correct.
And today, so I rather than me telling the story, I would be very happy, Aman, if you can take down through your journey. You know, we have solid half an hour, 35 minutes. Tell the students, tell them about how your life was, how did you come across, and how did you start up the startup? And then we'll open it for Q&A. And I'm sure someday, you know, some of them can get in touch with you, get to do some digital marketing and learn from you that, chalo yaar, hamara bhi bhaiya hai, bada wala, then.
Yeah.
So, Aman, over to you. Yeah, thank you so much. Yes.
Hi, guys. Good morning, by the way. And thank you, you know, thank you, Samson. And thank you, everyone, for calling me. And, you know, it's a little surreal that, you know, someone who just hated going to class in VIT is today, you know, sort of talking to you guys on screen about my journey. But, you know, like Sam sir said, you know, we were all the same. We were all, just going through college, having fun, not realizing what we want to do. Honestly, you know, in fact, I wasn't so privileged in college to know for sure that, you know, I wanted to do this in life. Or I wanted to do that in life. In fact, you know, like midway through, I wasn't even sure whether, engineering as such is my core field. So I'm sure a lot of you guys are going through the same thing where you guys are thinking, you know, pata nahi, like, you know, is this right? Is this not right? Am I doing it the right way? Am I not? Is this going to help me in life? Is that not? But, you know, trust me, everything eventually boils down and helps you out in some way or the other. You kind of find, you know, you kind of find one part of your journey through the entire thing. So, it kind of works out. So what I'll do is I've made a small PPT for you guys, which, you know, I'll kind of talk you guys through the PPT, and then that'll kind of explain my journey. So I'm just sharing my screen, Sam. So yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Right, can you guys see my screen?
Harshit, audience, can somebody quickly keep?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Keep unmuting and answering so that, yeah.
Great. So my company is called Tribe. This is our latest venture that we launched about, you know, 2 years ago odd. And this is a little bit about how we came up with the idea, how we actually executed it. And, you know, it's a little cliche and ridiculous when you hear it, but, you know, everything is very true. So who am I? So like Sam sir said, I'm an ex-VIT Vellore student. I did my BTech in computer science. I was also part of Toastmasters, where, you know, I met Sam sir and we got quite tight, and, you know, we were all of a similar mindset. So we all really gelled. We had a lot of fun in college, a little more than required. We got punished, caught, and this, that, left, right, and center. But, you know, in terms of our academics, in terms of learning from each other, you know, we were all quite active. You know, academics is not only going to class, and, you know, learning is not only going to class, you know. So what I today even realize is, you know, the network that you make in college, the friends that you make, the things that you learn from your teachers and professors outside class, sometimes is even more important than what you learn on class. You know, that's kind of where ideas stick, where you get things, where you learn things. So after VIT, I went to the University of Warwick in the UK, where I did my master's in e-business management, because I realized after VIT that even though I love technology, I wanted to be somewhere in the creative management field. So e-commerce was something that was a very good gray area for me, which I realized at that time that the world is going towards massively. So e-commerce was something I wanted to do. So this course was completely about how to run an e-commerce business online, how to do digital marketing, how to do branding, data analytics, stuff like that. So after that, I worked in Bombay for 2.5 years at this company called Rummy Circle, which was into online rummy and gaming. So I was in their digital marketing team. So I learned my trade there, which was a lot of data analytics, a lot of boring numbers you can say today, but quite fascinating, you know, the way you guys sometimes think that, you know, I say something and I see the ad on my phone, or I spoke about something and I see the ad on Instagram. You know, it's all predictive analytics and digital marketing that, you know, can predict extremely well what you are searching for and what time you're searching for. So I did that. But then somewhere in the back of my mind, I always knew that I wanted to start my own thing. At least give it a shot, you know, because I read, I mean, all of us on Instagram, you know, we keep following all these pages and you keep reading these quotes and, you know, from these founders and this, that. And I was like, you know, I definitely want to at least give it a shot. So after this, I started my own company, which was called The Impression Company. That was more of an agency that, you know, that ran social media campaigns, digital marketing. I was still kind of figuring out what I wanted to do. And while doing that, basically all this time after I went to the University of Warwick, the thing is, when I lived in VIT, you know, I was in K block, F block, A block in VIT. So I remember the hostels there, right? So when I went to Warwick, I kind of expected something on similar levels. But, you know, when I went into my room there, I was like, you know, this is fantastic. I mean, I have my own bathroom, first of all, you know, with a tub in it. And I have my own, like, bed. And there's a kitchenette. And there's a huge table. And, like, there's housekeeping. And there's laundry. And, you know, like what is going on? So that is kind of where the idea got ingrained in our head that this could be something. But we still needed some time to kind of be sure about what this was. So after, you know, I mean, 1 or 2 years down.
Aman, are you sharing your screen? We are in the slide called
Where Am I?
Ah, perfect.
I will be moving ahead.
What is a tribe?
Yes. So after that, basically, we got the idea of tribe. And we said, you know, we need to do something about hostel living and just living for bachelors in India, which was a big problem. And the last year, I received the Young Indian Achievers Award for excellence in marketing as well. So what is Tribe? Tribe is India's first luxury student hostel operator. Like I said, the idea we got was from, you know, when I went to Warwick versus VIT versus living alone versus listening to people's problems around me where they couldn't find a place to stay and students would have issues and they would take apartments and they would be thrown out of apartments and it was just a huge mess. So we realized that there is a huge, huge demand in India for this. So Tribe is now 2 years old. We have 550 beds in 4 properties in 2 cities in India, that is Bombay and Pune. And we plan to hit about 1,000 beds in 4 cities by the end of this year. That is the plan. All the pictures you see in this presentation are all actual pictures of our properties, by the way. So this is the kind of, you know, the kind of room that we kind of built. So what is our mission at Tribe? Our mission is to be the best possible student living experience in India with the happiest customers. So we are very, very focused on customer service. You know, being the biggest is something, but then having the best experience for someone, changing their actual lives, giving them a service, you know, that is up to mark or probably the best in the country is something that everyone should also think about, right? So that is our mission. So to give you guys a brief, Tribe has closed 3 rounds of investments of a pre-series A. We closed our last round in August 2019 during the pandemic. And we've closed a total of $3 million. And we plan to do a big series A round this year, hopefully, if things work out this year or early next year. So this is where we are in terms of investments. So now the story, we actually just had the idea once, you know, when we were sitting in a coffee shop and, you know, I was looking for a place to stay in Bombay when I came back and, you know, my dad, me and my brother were sitting and we were like, you know, it's so difficult for me to find a place in Bombay. Even when I'm working, I'm earning, you know, going through like brokers and places and they don't want bachelors and bachelors hai, to non-veg mat khao. नहीं तो फ्रेंड्स को मत लेके आओ घर पे तुम्हारी गर्लफ्रेंड नहीं आ सकती है तुम ये नहीं कर सकते हो वो नहीं कर सकते हो लाइक इट वाज जस्ट अ मेस राइट सो वी वर लाइक वी नीड टू कम अप विद सम आइडिया टू सॉल्व दिस प्रॉब्लम इट इज एन एक्चुअल रियल प्रॉब्लम दैट एवरीवन इज फेसिंग सो वी रोट डाउन द आइडिया ऑन अ पेपर दैट ओके इफ वी हैड टू क्रिएट समथिंग लाइक दिस इज व्हाट द अमेनिटीज वुड बी दिस इज हाउ वी वुड मेक इट एंड दिस इज हाउ मच वी वुड प्रोबेबली चार्ज इट वाज लिटरली ऑन अ पीस ऑफ पेपर यू नो सो it went from there. We started talking to people. We decided that, you know, this is something we want to concentrate on and let's see where it goes. So we made a PPT, we made a basic branding. We went around, started talking to people in our networks. What do you think of this idea? We started doing research abroad, internationally, in India, if there was something like this. And then we realized there was nothing. So we registered Tribe in 2017 with the same mission that I said before. So why did we start Tribe? Again, like I said, we figured out, so, you know, there is a lot of research that you have to do before also starting a company, right? So there, I mean, you can't just, you know, have a basic idea and then, I mean, obviously you can go start it, but you need to have some calculations in mind before, you know, and now you have Google, you have the internet, you know, so it's quite easy to find information on what you want to do, how you want to do it. So we realized that there was a huge need. So this again came from, you know, my VIT experience where we would listen to people saying that, you know, I want to like get a place outside, but I can't find something. When I was in Bombay, I would listen to so many people like, you know, arguing and just, you know, in a mess that, you know, we can't find a decent place to stay. And I'm looking for flatmates and they would go on these Facebook groups. So we realized there was a huge need for this. Again, our research said that there was nothing like this in the country. So we knew that there were a couple of operators who were operating, but I mean, they were still doing the basic, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 shared in a room, you know, where you would pay about 10 to 15,000 bucks a month and you would get the basic services, you know, a little better than, you know, a typical hostel. But we wanted something that we had seen when we had studied abroad. So we were like, why can't we bring that to India? Why can't we bring that quality to India? And I'll tell you guys something that we realized, right, that, you know, India is not a very price sensitive market. That is probably the biggest myth that people have about Indians. People think Indians don't like to spend money. People think Indians want something cheap. It is not a price sensitive market. It is a value for money market. If you give someone something that they, that, you know, is providing them a lot, people will go out of their way to spend money for this, something like this, you know? So we realized that there was nothing like this. We knew we had the vision and know-how. We were very, very sure about the price points that we were talking about. And a lot of people told us, you guys are mad. I mean, the best hostel in India currently privately charges about 13,000 to 15,000 bucks a month. You guys want to enter at 25, 30,000 bucks a month. You know, that is, I mean, people in India don't spend. Why would someone spend 3 lakh rupees a year on just hostel stay when currently someone is spending 1.5 lakh rupees? But we were very sure of that. So you have to have some faith in yourself. We realized home searching is a huge headache everywhere for people. We realize that now this bachelor issue has become a thing everywhere in all cities. You know, like I said, bachelors, they don't like, they don't give it to students, societies don't like them, they don't let them live, there are a lot of issues. And then there was no other place for them to go, right? And of course, demand, right? So India, we knew, had the most number of students in the world and the most number of traveling students in the world, city to city. So we knew that there was a huge clientele. We knew that if the total number of students were X in India, you know, I mean, only say one fifth of that was serviced in actually properly built hostels. So there was 4/5 of Indian students who did not have a place, a proper place to stay. So all these things were checkmarked. We were very confident of our decision on why we wanted to start this company and how this would help us. So these are some of the pictures. So these are our actual hostels. This is the one in Viman Nagar, Pune. We've gotten multiple awards for this, including internationally and Indian. So, you know, this is the kind of quality that we were looking for. You know, everything from every chair to every table, to the branding, to the design, to, you know, we did research on things like how many plug points should a student use, where they should use it, how much electricity a student consumes, what are the biggest problems in the bathroom or in common areas. And this has all come from personal experience, right? Living in VIT, Emborik, and Bombay. So I've had this experience firsthand. So I knew what I would want and how I would flout the rules. You know, things like curfew timing. We did away with curfew timing completely. And we realized that, you know, that was a master stroke. So a lot of other companies started doing that after we did it. You know, this is our Mumbai property. This again, you know, every property of ours has won multiple awards year on year for design, interiors, for quality of property. You know, every property of ours has specific chill zones, work zones, study zones, different types of rooms. We realize that, you know, people need places to interact, to have fun. So this is our Mumbai hostel. So going ahead, you know, once we signed up, you know, we found our first investor from someone we knew from our own network, who, you know, who was a young guy. We told him the idea, you know, he was quite sold on it. He realized that there is nothing like this and he wanted to do it. So he was our first investor. With that investment, we basically created our first property in Viman Nagar in Pune with 192 beds. That is the picture of the building. So, you know, we got our architects in place. We went through Pinterest every day. We got, you know, so many design ideas. You know, I worked on the branding, marketing, the logos, how it should feel, look, how a person should move through it. So there's a lot of thought that has gone into it. You know, it's not just ki flat utha liya, boat dal diya, bed sheet change kar diya, aur hostel bana diya, right? We created an entire facility. So each facility of ours has a cafe that runs 24/7, has a gym, has chill zones, like I said. And surprisingly, we launched at the highest price in India at the time, and we sold out within 4 months of launching. So this is obviously a culmination of having a great product, great marketing, a great brand. We sold almost everything through Instagram, and you know, by tying up with colleges, I would literally be on the road and distribute pamphlets to parents and students, you know, initially, that this is what we're doing. They would come see it and they would book. So, you know, we were finally, you know, there was a luxury student accommodation in India, which was proper luxury. You know, we were the first ones who were doing it. So we did have a first mover advantage, which makes a big difference. We were also disrupting an entire industry, you know, that was not touched or that was just slightly improved, you know, for the last 100 years or say 1,000 years, you know, even when you had like gurus and rishis, they would have people come, you know, to hostels and stay and learn, right? So this was something that we were literally completely remodeling, you know, as an industry. So we didn't have anyone to copy. We couldn't see what others were doing. We were the ones who were doing everything. We were the ones coming up with ideas every day. And, you know, that's how we were doing that. So this was in 2019, March. Towards mid-2019, we launched our second hostel in Mumbai after picking up a second investment, because we had our proof of concept done. We had sold out. Now investors were looking very evidently at Tribe. You know, they were seeing that, okay, this is a concept that works. We never thought something this expensive would sell out. So then people started circling. People started meeting us for investments. So we closed our second investment and opened our building in Bombay. This is a girls' hostel, which is a complete Mediterranean-themed hostel as well, with 75 beds. And after these two were out, all the awards started flowing in. So, you know, we had, you know, people call us from Times, from Asia One magazine, from Business World. We received the Business Excellence Award for Hospitality Projects of the Year. Estate Awards gave us Student Housing of the Year. Asia One magazine featured us. Pool magazine gave us the Best Architecture and Interiors Award in that year as well. We got featured on the cover of Business magazine, actually, with a complete spread inside. We got our first international feature by Architecture Digest, which is one of the most respected magazines in architecture internationally. So that featured us just for our interiors, because this was something completely new. I mean, when you talk to people about a hostel today, the first thing you think about is bunk bed, common mess, common toilets, chill zone, play area, right? You don't think of, you know, these kind of luxuries or these kind of interiors, right? So this is something that was completely new. Then, you know, once these awards started coming in, all the news channels, the newspapers, the blogs, everyone started approaching us for interviews. You know, we won Hindustan Times, Business Standard, BW, Financial Times, Business World. We were literally everywhere. For the next 6 months, you know, this was kind of an eye-opening thing, and we were kind of everywhere. So it was a lot to take in. But obviously, you know, we knew we were on something good. We knew we had done our market research well. So, you know, going ahead, we are obviously dreaming of big things. So we are also planning to launch probably not India's, but Asia's largest student housing project with 1,600 beds. That is the actual architecture design. I can't reveal where this is coming up now, but we are on the verge of signing this and picking up a huge investment for this as well. It is a complete township, which we are building for students, where we'll have a movie theater, complete sports arenas, you know, restaurants, you know, cafes, everything from bowling alleys to stuff like that as well, including complete housekeeping, this, that, completely serviced. You know, we plan to enter a total of 6 tier 1 and tier 2 cities by 22, currently we have four projects in Pune and Mumbai, like I mentioned, with 551 beds. We plan to enter, you know, about four more cities within the next 1 year. And we have a target of about 1,500 to 2,000 beds by 22. We also plan to get into co-living, you know, which is a natural extension for us, because now we've cracked the student housing market, and now we're planning to move into the market for working professionals, because, you know, we don't want to mix both. A lot of people are doing that. We know that the entire atmosphere experience that we create for students is slightly different. For working people, you know, we will have co-working spaces, bars, you know, restaurants, complete fitness centers, networking events, stuff like that as well. So that is a completely different project that we're planning to do by 2022. And we've just signed it. I'm sure a lot of you guys have questions about, you know, with a company that is just 1 year old, how do you deal with something like a pandemic, you know, that comes into play? So, you know, the COVID pandemic obviously was extremely difficult for us. We literally had, I mean, our business is black and white, right? We either have people living there or we don't have people living there, right? If colleges are open, they're open. If they're shut, they're shut. There is no in-between occupancy or, I mean, there was no travel, there were no working people. So we were completely shut for the last, 10 months. So we had no students, we had no occupancy. This entire year was only about survival. It was difficult. You know, we obviously built up a lot of losses. There had to be a lot of renegotiations done with building owners, landowners, you know, with vendors. We had to go through a lot of angry vendors, you know, but, you know, everyone understood that, you know, that everyone was in the same boat. You know, luckily we work with very good people in all spheres. We choose the people we work with very well. So we had to come up with, you know, new procedures for COVID, testing, sanitization. These were all extra costs that had to be added in. We had to figure out how to survive the year, how to build on our losses. People were canceling. They had to be given, you know, deposits back, refunds back. We didn't have cash flow. So there were a lot of things that we had to get through. But this entire year was only survival. There was nothing else. It was whoever survives this year has made it. You know, we had one of our biggest competitors, you know, called Oxford Caps, that shut down their company during the pandemic, you know, because of, you know, issues that they faced. You know, they had 30,000 beds in the country and they had to literally shut down. So just surviving this pandemic was a huge win for us. So after all this, you know, today we are at 550 beds, you know, within 2 years of launching. We've had 100% year-on-year growth. This is excluding the pandemic. Yeah, I mean, that is a cancel year for everyone. So these are our two newest properties. The left one is the one in Wakhad in Pune, and the center one is Koregaon Park. So now we have four properties ready to sell. So, you know, like I said, we're in these four properties currently: Vimannagar, Vile Parle, Wakhad, and Koregaon Park. We plan to enter Delhi and Bangalore are our next two targets. We also are looking at places like Indore. Maybe if Samsur helps us, then AP, Vellore, you know, these kind of places. If we can
work through, yes.
And, you know, speak to the university, do something like this, you know, for the students there as well. Manipal we're in talks with as well. So there are a lot of, you know, in fact, something very interesting that I would like to tell you all is, you know, we have suddenly started seeing universities have started realizing that, you know, running hostels is not their prime forte. Their prime forte is educating children, right? So hostel running is not a small job. It is a very big job. And, you know, people have issues, rooms are not clean, hygiene, stuff like that. So they have realized that why not we tie up with private operators to come and take over existing on-campus hostels. So we have started receiving a lot of interest from some huge universities like NMIMS. You know, we are going to be in talks with some big universities in Delhi, you know, even down south, who are telling us that, you know, why don't you build our newer hostels, take over them, and, you know, we'll do some sort of an agreement between us. So that is something which is a completely new concept that we have also surprisingly started seeing, and we are actively moving towards. In fact, this just 5 days ago, you know, we received Student Housing of the Year for 2021. We received this award last year as well. You know, there are about a good 15 top companies in the country right now who are actively expanding. So, you know, winning this award, you know, is a big deal for us. It's good recognition. We know we're on the right track. So these are some of the biggest learnings that, you know, I mean, there are obviously, you know, there are hundreds of them, you know, there are so many every day that you learn with the people you meet, investments, negotiation, but, you know, these are some of the biggest ones, you know. So the first one was, you know, a great quality product rarely fails. So, you know, a lot of times, you know, we used to have arguments that, you know, why do we have to spend, you know, small things like, why do we have to spend, like, you know, 1,000 rupees on a chair when we can get a plastic chair for 200? It does the same job. Why do we have to spend 1,500 rupees on this light fixture when we can get, you know, a decent light fixture in 300 bucks? Why do we have to spend, you know, 2,000 rupees extra on a better mattress when you can get a basic mattress, you know, for like 2,000 rupees less? You know, we had arguments over all these things, but then, you know, this was something my dad realized, and, you know, this is something that has helped me a lot. He's been into real estate for very long. He's come up with some innovative ideas. And, you know, he always told us that, you know, never compromise on quality. People eventually fall in love with quality. When today you use an iPhone, you know, the first time you use an iPhone, after that, you could never go back to something else. You know, there are some people who blindly use an iPhone or a Samsung or a OnePlus, right? When you get something of great quality, it is very difficult for you to leave that and go back somewhere else, you know, which is why we have such high retention rates. I mean, I'm expecting a retention rate of 75% this year. So 75% of my existing students are planning to renew this year, right? Why? Because once they've come and tasted this sort of quality, even if they get something at a 50% discount, they will never go back to that again, because you've tasted it. You've gotten used to a certain standard of living. So that is something that we learned, you know, never compromise on quality. You know, even if you have to spend a little extra, charge extra, but give that extra. You know, people like quality and value for money. Then the second thing was, you know, how and where you showcase your product is as important as your product itself. So, you know, creating a great product is fine. You know, you can create a great, you know, SAP product, you can create a great, you know, real estate product like this, you can create a great, you know, a tech product, anything that you're selling can be great. But if you don't know how to sell it, where to sell it, and how you show off your product, it is extremely important. It is as important as the product. So this is where your brand, your marketing, how you do your marketing, how you do your brand, consistency, how you make your presentations, you know, how you sell to people, the way you made your office. These things matter a lot, you know, a lot. We have seen that firsthand. That is why we sold out in 4 months, right? The way, like, you know, for example, I'll give you a small example, you know, this entire photo shoot that I've done for this project, right? A photo shoot like this could have very easily been done by, you know, a decent photographer in, say, 40,000 or 50,000 rupees. But we spent 2 lakh rupees, got a French photographer who specializes in architecture, because we knew that these photos are going to sell. If it looks great on photos, people start believing it. If your website looks great, people start getting a good luxury experience from the start. They start believing it. You know, you go through things, you're like, oh, this looks nice. It feels nice. So the product must be good. So it's helped us a lot, you know. Another thing that, you know, people keep coming and telling me is, you know, what if someone else, like, you know, someone big puts in money, just copies your product and goes and starts it tomorrow. You know, that is something that, you know, a lot of people tell us, you know, this is something that I'm sure a lot of people have heard around, that, you know, this guy will come and just copy your product and do it. You know, they can always copy your product, but they can never copy how you do it. You know, they can never copy your brand. They can never copy your service. They can never copy, you know, the way you make someone feel, the way you run the entire story. You know, that is something that will always differentiate you from the others, right? So there are so many other players now who have come into the market, you know, claiming luxury. But, you know, they are still at 50% occupancy. We still have a waiting list of 200 people. Why? It is the way we treat people, the way we are progressive about our rules and regulations. You know, like, you know, we know that people go out, people get drunk, people come back. There is a way we treat them. We don't tell them you're not allowed inside. You know, we don't have curfew. We have co-ed hostels, you know, where the world is moving towards. Segregated, but co-ed hostels. You know, we've realized that if you treat people like adults, they behave like adults. The more rules and regulations you put on people, sometimes, you know, they tend to break that a little more. So all these ideologies come together, which someone can never copy. So, you know, always have faith in what you're doing and do it well and do it the way you want to do it. Another thing which is very, very, very important is LinkedIn. So, you know, I'm sure a lot of people have heard that LinkedIn is great. You should do things on LinkedIn. You should be active there. You should have a profile. But trust me, guys, you know, two of our biggest investments have come through LinkedIn. Sam Sir and I connected again through LinkedIn. We have gotten 2 properties through LinkedIn. Our next biggest Series A round you know, which is a huge round, might happen because of a connect that we made through LinkedIn. He saw our thing, he connected with us, he said, can we talk? And we started talking. Being active on LinkedIn is probably one of the biggest tips that I can give you guys today. You know, it is a very, very, very good platform. Another thing is, you know, I keep seeing a lot of people around, you know, now I can say it, you know, since I've done it a little bit, I've gone through this. I keep seeing people saying, oh, dude, I have this great idea. You know, I've like thought of this thing for so long and I know this is going to be a hit, but I'm just like waiting to get like the right mix. You know, I'm just waiting to get like the right business model. I'm just waiting to, you know, think of some things and get it done. Just start. There is no right time to wait. If you don't start now, a lot of you will realize in the next 1 year, someone's taken it straight. You have to start now. You have to just start. You have to go through it. There is no planning, okay, from this week to this week, I'll do this. Then this week to this week, I'll do this. And this week to this week, I'll do this. It does not happen. You have to start. You have to jump into it, make a list and start ticking off. That is the only way of doing it. The more you wait, someone else is going to take it. Trust me on that. There are millions of people in the world and everyone is thinking of the same thing eventually. And probably the last most important thing is, you know, in business, obviously, you know, I don't have any business knowledge. I haven't studied it. I'm a tech guy, you know, like you guys know, I've studied marketing and I've studied like, you know, technology and computer science. But everything eventually in a business is going to come down to how you negotiate, how you sit across a table with someone. Trust me, guys. I mean, you know, you guys might be wondering, you know, how it feels to close investments of $2 million, $3 million, you know, where probably talking about investments coming in now, you know, upwards of $20 million, $30 million. So how does it feel? Like, how do you come down to a number like that? How do you do valuations? You know, how do you talk about a company? So, you get agencies who will come, who will do your valuation of your company. They'll put in 5 models. They'll do multipliers of top lines. They'll do this, that. Eventually, it's going to come down to us on this side of the table, them on that side of the table. And it comes down to what number you guys can finalize on. It is as simple as that. Everything from your vendors to investors to negotiators will eventually come down to how you know how to negotiate. So I would say read books about it, learn methods of how to negotiate. In fact, Samsa, I would suggest if you hold, you know, I'm sure you're great at this. If you can hold a lecture on how to negotiate, the different ideas of negotiation, this is something that I had learned in university. Yeah. Because this is the most used to be my weakest point, and you know, I studied it, learned it, and you know, everything from a vendor to how much you sell to talking to a client to pricing a product to closing an investment, everything is how you negotiate and who says the number first, what you say in that moment. That is it. So, you know, these are some of the biggest learnings that I've had. You know, there are lots more that I can talk about, but these are the basic ones. And this is where you can find me. You can find me on LinkedIn, on Instagram, on Facebook. I'm quite active on all these places. You know, you can always connect with me. I'm always happy to help Samsa students, you know, anytime. And thanks, guys. And thanks for having me. I hope this was a little informative. And, you know, you guys learned something. So, any questions?
All right. So... Good. Thank you, Aman. Thank you so much for your time. So now, guys, I'm sure you might have seen, you might have heard. All right. And it's such an amazing, mind-blowing thing how a student who just did technology and IT started a big thing.
Yeah.
And that was something which is like, come on, you know, with a high budget. So that's why I always tell my students, you need to have a gap in the market, and also you need to find the market in the gap.
Absolutely. Right?
Otherwise, you're gone. And so what we'll do is we'll open up for a quick questions, Mr. Aman. So, okay, students, now I've given you in the chat, the LinkedIn, the Instagram, the Facebook, everything. So start quickly going, start following, because you never know, you know?
Yeah.
There's so many amazing things. So quickly... unmute yourself and ask questions, because the more you participate, the more the learning, the more the score. Over to you quickly. Yeah. Any questions to Aman directly? Yes. Tell your name and then start off. Yes, quickly. And then we'll have a group pick at the end. Yeah. You guys can unmute yourself and then, Abraham, Amit, Lokesh, everyone, Harshit, whoever, yeah. Unmute yourself, introduce your name to Aman, and then talk. Yeah, ask questions. Because you guys are also having a hostel life and all that.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Okay, quick.
Sir, I am Harshit Har, sir. I want to ask a question to Mr. Aman Mehra. That is big investment essential for having a good startup, or it can work with small investments also?
See, it kind of depends on what your product is and what you want to do, right? Now, for example, the product that we have chosen, which is you know, student hostels, is something which requires a lot of investment in real estate, a lot of investment in interiors. So that is a product that we chose that needed an investment. But on the other hand, for example, my previous business, right? I started an agency that did marketing and data analytics. I put in 10,000 rupees. I started a website. I got two people to join me, and you can start a company, right? And you can build from there. You can bootstrap it. So it kind of depends on what your product model is. Here, to even have a starting, you know, proof of concept, I needed an investment. So that is the choice we took. But you really don't need an investment. I mean, I know people who have started tech products, who bootstrapped it, who, you know, put in just, you know, a couple of thousand rupees and, you know, started a website, got in the first clients and built from there, then got in the next clients and built from there. So it kind of totally depends on your product. But to scale, eventually you do need an investment. That I will take.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
No worries.
Thanks for your question. Introduce your name, please.
Hello, good evening. Good afternoon. I'm Satvik.
Hi,
like, what my query is, like, what made you jump from a technical 9-to-5 to a business oriented job? I mean, like, there has to be some confidence in your idea, or what made you go through those phases? Like, technical 9-to-5 will give you comfort, right? What made you do the business?
Right. So there are two questions with this. So first, I'll answer why I moved from technical to a management or creative field. So I've always naturally been a creative thinker. I've always been a creative guy. I was always into design, photography, but I was very good at science. So, you know, I always used to get confused whether I should follow something I really liked and, you know, was very interested in, or something that I was very good at. But eventually I decided to kind of take a mid pathway. So I realized digital marketing, branding, and, you know, stuff like that was a very good mid path for me, which I could enhance my creativity, but it is also a technical field. I also handle the technology for Tribe. So we built our own ERP systems from scratch. You know, our entire website design has been done at our end. So, you know, it's a good mix of these things. Now, I moved, you know, from a job to a business. So let's say this kind of came down from my dad as well. He's always been an entrepreneur. You know, so there are a lot of advantages of having, you know, a 9-to-5 job. Because you have security, you know, you have stability, you have processes set in place, you know, there is more peace of mind. And on the business front, you know, you have every day is firefighting sometimes. You know, you are just solving problems every day. You are just figuring out issues. Sometimes you run out of cash, sometimes. But then you also have great times, you know, when you close investments, when you have stake in the company that is growing, when your valuations are growing. So your ceiling is very high when you start a business. In general, in terms of how much money you can earn, how much money you can make, what you can do, you know, to change a landscape. So you have that freedom in the business, and you know you're the boss. So that kind of feeling gives you. But then there are a lot of downsides as well. So it kind of depends on how you want to play your life. I hope that answers it.
Good, Satvik.
Excuse me, sir.
Tell your name, please.
I am Sheshank, sir. So, the same question as Satvik asks to sir, but my question is, how you? What if there is a failure in your hand at that particular time when you chose the technical side to the marketing side or startup time?
If there's a failure, I'm sorry, I'm not clearly understanding the question. So you mean I moved from technical to marketing?
What if that you would fail, that there would be another chance in technical side, or that was with a startup with this new job only?
I'm still not very clear on what you are asking. So you're saying that why I didn't start a technical thing and why I started something like a hostel?
Exactly, sir. But what if you fail in that marketing side, there would be another chance of including your technical side at your job responsibility?
Yes, absolutely. See, now I'll give you an example. Like, nothing goes to waste. Now, just because I haven't taken my life ahead, you know, in the completely technical field doesn't mean it's a waste. Now, you know, you guys need to understand one thing that which I have understood very recently, right? That when you come towards top level of management, or you're starting a company, you are not literally sitting and coding every day. I am not coding my website every day. I am not making my ERP systems every day. I am not literally doing my, you know, social media marketing every day. But I am managing different teams. I have gotten different teams from different places who have plugged into my startup ecosystem, which is your lean startup ecosystem. The important thing is knowing what needs to be done, what doesn't need to be done, and making good decisions. For that, this experience will always help me. So I know, I understand how technology works. This is basically VIT teaches you, right? It teaches you how technology works, how things work. So that I will always use in my entrepreneurial journey, you know. So even if I mean, which is why even this entire hostel thing, a lot of the play is digital. A lot of the play is technology. A lot of the experiences that we build internally are based around technology. So that has always helped.
Wow.
Hi, I'm Atresh.
Hi.
Yeah. My question is more regarding the scaling and people in general in a startup. So what usually happens is that when you start a startup, I'm actually currently interning in a startup and, you know, doing more than an intern. Usually what happens is that the first three or four people are the ones who are very much invested into the product and have a connection, also are equally are the more talented, or let's say people who are going to do the work and everything for the product. But then once you start scaling up, you don't get the people who are as invested as the first three people were. So how do you deal with that and things like that?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question, honestly. Thanks for asking. So probably the most difficult thing, but the most important thing in a startup is honestly the people that you get. You know, so everything is not hunky-dory. It's not like I've just hit upon a great team out of nowhere, or it's just a fluke, right? So like you said, you know, very correctly, you know, the first team, the core team that you make is, you know, like, you know, my head of operations, my head of sales, my head of business development. You know, these guys are guys who we spent a lot of time and effort into finding the right people who believe in the idea. It has to be someone who believes in the idea. Okay, tomorrow, even if, you know, push comes to shove and shit goes down the drain, you know, they should still feel like it is a great product and we will do whatever it takes to help you. They have to be as invested as you. Once that is done, you know, you start, obviously, you build a culture, you build a company culture. This is where, you know, building company culture comes into play. You know, how you treat your staff. You have to continuously motivate your staff again and again. It is, you know, COVID was a very difficult period for us to keep our staff motivated. You know, we made the conscious decision of making sure every single staff member of ours is paid during the COVID period. A lot of companies cut salaries. A lot of companies didn't pay staff, you know, like everyone knows. But we made a conscious decision that, you know, if we keep our staff and our people happy and make them believe in the product, you know, we want them to grow with us. We always motivate them. We always show them, you know, where we are going. You know, when things like these articles, awards come in, people get very motivated and they start believing in it, you know. So it is not easy. You have to sometimes mold people to believe in the product. You know, sometimes people come just to earn money, do a gig and leave. But, you know, eventually, I mean, after some time, you kind of realize who is what, who's looking for what. You end up meeting so many kinds of people throughout your entire journey. You kind of realize and tend to realize in 5 minutes who is what and what kind of a person. So it is not easy, but you have to continuously keep molding them towards your vision, your mission, all the time.
Thank you.
Hello. Yes, my name is Amit. And my question is more of related to your startup itself. And my question was, what were the like basic points you had in mind while you were choosing a flat or a site when you wanted to buy an hostel or anything? For example, it could be the vicinity of the hostel to a school or college, for example.
Correct.
What were the points that were in your mind?
you know, there are a good question, by the way. So there are a couple of there are a couple of different things that you look at from different perspectives. You know, this is why it's good to have different minds in your team. So one time it's looked at from a real estate perspective on how viable it is as a real estate product, how much money we have to invest in it, what the landlord is looking for, what is the deal like. From a marketing perspective, which is the market research that I do for every project, is again, how close is it to a college who has a minimum X amount of fees? We know for a fact that if someone is paying a minimum of 2 to 3 lakh rupees a fee, they are okay paying 2 to 3 lakh rupees for hostel stay. We have realized that over our time, right? So that is one thing that is very important. Is the target market someone who is conscious of quality, who has the aspiration to come and stay in something like this? Can we educate the customer on some product like this? That is done. Then we look at how many students are there in the neighboring colleges, how many hostels are there in the neighboring colleges, what is the demand like? That. Apart from that, you know, like I said, on the real estate front, what is the deal that the landowner wants? Is it a JV? Is it a pure rental agreement? What is the money that we require to turn this building around? Does it make sense for us? After this, there is a finance analysis done from my finance team where they then look at, okay, so if like worst case scenarios, if we close the hostel at 50% occupancy this year, what is our break evens? If we close at 70, 80, 90, how much money are we making out of this hostel? What is the probability that we can increase our pricing from 10 to 15% every year on this? Now, for example, in Bombay, we start at 45,000 rupees a bed. In Vimannagar, we started at 21,000 rupees. Today, we are charging 30,000 rupees for the same bed with zero negotiation because we know that there is potential here. There is nothing else around. There is no competition around. There is a high demand. So there are a lot of these things that come into play when you choose a hostel. So this is the kind of process that we go through.
Yes, so continue with my question. Now you have set up your startup in like Mumbai and Pune. It's a big metropolitan city. When it comes to university levels like Manipal or Vellore, for example, how are you going to deal with it having it in a like not kind of a rural place but near a big university like Vellore or Manipal, which is not a metropolitan city, or you're not going to get that much revenue from places like this because students won't be able to afford this huge amount of fees from these kind of places, or it could be SRM or any huge university levels.
Correct. Absolutely. So, again, good question. So what happens is that is a misconception that people... So the thing is, this is a product that no one has seen, right? So until you come and see it and feel it, you don't realize that you are okay paying so much for this kind of a product. Before using an iPhone, you would always use like, you know, the best BlackBerry. You would pay, like 25,000 bucks for a phone and you'd be like, I have a great phone. But the first, you would never in your dreams think that I would pay 70,000 rupees or 80,000 rupees for a phone. You'd be like, are you mad at that time? You'd be like, why would I spend 80,000 rupees on a phone when the best phone is right now for 25,000-30,000 bucks, right? But when the iPhone came out, you used it, you saw what it was, and today people are paying 1,60,000 rupees for a top-end iPhone, left, right, and center, right? So you create a market, you create the demand, you provide the quality of product, and it becomes aspirational. I'll give you an example. The person who's working in my kitchen here saved money for 1.5 years so he could buy an iPhone 7 from his salary.
Wow.
So you are creating aspiration in someone's head. So you are creating something where someone says, I don't care, I will not travel this year, but I want to stay at Tribe. We had someone who gave up her IIM course. It was a very far off IIM in a rural place. She gave up her IIM course because she wanted to come and stay in Tribe and study in Symbiosis. Because she's like, I don't want to live in a rural place, but I want to stay at Tribe. So answering your question, in tier 2 cities, in fact, we are seeing that students have a very, very high demand for something like this and are okay paying it. Because in cities, at least you have other options. You can get a decent flat somewhere, fully furnished buildings, stuff like that, you know, society. In tier 2 areas, there's nothing. So when you're dealing with scale, like when, for example, VIT, you're dealing with 15, 20,000 students. You know, when your hostels are made for 4,000 to 5,000 students and you have 10,000 students empty, out of which I am targeting 1%.
Yeah.
Which is not a big deal. I am targeting 1% to 2% of your entire student crop. That is anyway exceeding how many beds I can service. So when you play the value of game, I mean, the value of scale, tier 2 cities, in fact, are a huge, huge market for us on the other end.
Wow.
Thank you. Just hope you continue with Tier 2 cities, build your portfolio to Tier 2 and Tier 3 cities.
Yeah, I hope so. Very
cool. Amit Vardhan, a very good question. You need to keep in touch with Aman Mehra, all right, and see how you guys can collaboratively learn. Yeah. Okay, quick. So before Thank we you. Close any last questions, I think so only boys are going to get high score for the participation, and I don't think any girls. All right.
So hello, I'm Satya.
Hi.
So I wanted to ask, do you have any tips from your experience to a person who has been in a technical side from the very beginning and who wants to start a company like you, like something? Do you have any tips for a person, that kind of person, from experience?
Who wants to start a company like me, as in a non-tech focused, I mean, a non-purely tech company. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
See, I'll tell you what. You know, a lot of times, sometimes you guys might agree with me, sometimes you might not agree with me. So, you know what engineering, I mean, what I've realized is what engineering teaches you, like, you know, a lot of the things that I've learned in college is not, like, I don't remember how to code. I don't remember what I learned in my classes, right? What engineering and technical fields teach you is how to analyze things properly and how to make good decisions based on your analysis. It is as simple as that. So even if you're doing something technical, what you are being molded in for is how to think of a problem logically, how to not panic, how to think of different solutions, what are the different ways you can solve it, what is the best probable solution, and solve it. So whether you want to tomorrow make a toothbrush brand, you want to make an online website tech product, or you want to sell peanuts, everything is going to come down from the help that you get in learning from VIT and, you know, courses like this. So don't ever think ki only because you have technology, you can't do something else. By the way, guys, any company you start in the world today is going to be 30% based on tech. Anything. You want to sell a toothbrush, you have to advertise it. You have to create a website. You have to create a backend ERP. You have to run softwares. You want to sell peanuts, you have to brand it. You have to market it. You have to sell it online. You have to have another website. And you have to know how to basically track your entire thing using ERP solutions. Everything in the world today has a 30% tech behind it. So the fact that you guys are learning tech is always going to be a huge upmarket piece. So never think you can't do anything else. It is always going to help you out.
Good. Aman, can you just tell them a little bit about what is the Series A? Because everywhere there is Series A, Series B investment. So what is that Series A? Just for them in a basic.
Right. So, you usually have, you know, these terminologies that have come into the investment circle, where you have something called a seed round. A seed round is basically the fund that you pick up to build your proof of concept in general. Mm-hmm. So, okay, like I picked up a seed round, I have built one property, I have sold it out, I have serviced it. This is my proof of concept. Now an investor ahead knows that this model is a hit, it can work. That is your seed round. A pre-series A is usually a round which is somewhere in the range of say 10 to, I mean, say about 7 to $15 million is kind of what a pre-series A is usually given, that kind of a range, which is a smaller, investment, but a significant investment to get you to a very big jump. Mm-hmm. Pre-series A rounds are basically smaller investments that you get before that to reach to a valuation where you can command a series A. So if I am, for example, getting a $10-15 million investment, I'm not going to dilute like 70% of my equity, right? I'm going to probably dilute, like say 10 or 15 or maximum 20% of my equity at that time if it's very required. So to reach that valuation, that is what a Series A is. And then a Series B starts coming more towards a 40 to 80, $100 million. So it is a very vague range of terminology, but it just basically gives you an idea that Series A is okay, a big investment that they've got. Series B is okay, the next big investment, which is now scaling you to multiple cities, to a much larger thing. And then a CDE can just go on to, you know, ridiculous numbers. That is kind of what it means.
Good. Thanks, Aman. It was wonderful to see how, you got a big market in the big space. And I know it's not small. Getting a hostel fee beyond an academic fee is something which is like, you know, because of your experience in abroad in UK. And the best thing is you came back and at a very young age, you have taken it to a totally different level. Correct. So we want to wish you the best luck. I'm sure that students might have really understood that, you know, someone who studied in VIT, you know. So can you just tell before we close, what is it, a little message that what all you did in VIT in university beyond academics? I know you were into Toastmasters. So what is it you want them to do? Because I don't want them to just sit and code and also campus life, like how we picked out. You know? Yeah. Just a message before we close. Yeah.
So what I would do apart from that is you need to read a lot. And I'm not talking about reading books. You know, a lot of you guys might be like, you know, that I don't like books. But try to spend time reading. So, you know, you have apps like Flipboard, which is my favorite app. It is an app that I've been using for the last 10 years, right? Where you can follow news about what is happening around and build a lot of and make a lot of friends in college. I will tell you guys that. Make a lot of friends in college because everyone you're meeting today in VIT is here for a reason. Everyone is smart. Everyone is a certain level of smart. And everyone, you know, eventually tends to do something great in life. You don't know tomorrow who you're going to meet, who's going to help you out, who's going to be in touch with you, from who you'll get an investment and what you'll do tomorrow or who you might collaborate with. So make a lot of friends. That's what I did. I made a lot of friends in VIT, kept in touch with a lot of friends, and I read a lot. You know, so these are probably two of the most important things. Some of my VIT friends today are working with government tenders. They are helping companies, you know, close investments in Dubai and London. There's some of, they're working with the top law firms in England. You know, a lot of people are doing very different things. There's, you know, one of my friends from VIT, very close friends. We still like talk to each other and abuse each other when we talk to each other, you know, over calls and stuff like that. But he's helping the government with the entire, the distribution of the COVID vaccine in India. So he's managing that entire project. So a lot of people are doing great stuff. So make a lot of friends and be in touch with them, I would say. That is one advice I would give, yes.
Wow, good. So Aman, thank you so much. It was wonderful. It went beyond the time, and I really appreciate students' participation, and everything is noted. So guys, can you quickly switch on your cam? We're going to have a group pick and it'll be wonderful. I've given the tribe's Facebook page, Instagram page, like it, share it. We're going to do more of digital marketing. We will help our own, you know, VIT alumni. So everyone quickly switch on your cam because that is going to be the pick for our entire, yeah, Kurtik Raja has done. Quick, everybody. Right. We can even take because that's a way you show your respect. Thanks. Quick, everyone. I'll take a print screen and send it to. Do not worry about your background. Don't worry. You know, we are not staying in tribe. When you go to Pune and Mumbai, you can catch up with Aman and right. So, yeah. Quickly put on your pick, everyone. Yeah. Divya, there's only one girl. In the whole of the batch? Come on. No. There are many. Oh, yeah. Quick. Okay. So these are the guys who will definitely get others. Come on, quick. So as in when you were on. Okay. Anyone? Harshit, would just want to give a thanks on the video itself directly. Satya, just give a word of thanks to Aman bro. Yeah.
Thanks,
Akash Raj. Yeah. Quick. Unmute.
Yes, sir. Thank you for joining us. It was a great session speaking with you, and we learned a lot of things what we should concentrate on engineering and what we can do being from VIT.
Good.
Others, quick. Yeah. Satya. Amazing.
Yeah, thank you for your session. It was really amazing. We get to know about things that we didn't know before.
Like, great.
We can think.
Glad.
Yes, yeah. Thanks a lot, sir, for joining with us.
No worries, anytime.
And shared about your the past about and about your startup things. Thank you so much.
Sure. Anytime.
So Kartik Raja and Satya and Sashank, maybe after 5-10 years, I will do your session, interview you, and then bring you to the class. If God willing, we are all there together. Yeah.
Sure, sir.
So good. Thank you. All right. Okay. Thanks all. Thank you so much. And anyway, the whole
session
is recorded. Aman, my kya karunga, I'll just download this and again put it in all your social media and YouTube. And may you just expand and keep scaling up. And one line which I will not forget is not just value for money or price sensitive market. We are in a value for money market. That really made sense. Yeah. So if you have a good value for money, people will buy it.
Absolutely.
All right. So I wish that these students who have taken this course. I don't know why they took this course, but I'm very sure that, you know, no pandemic can stop them like how you did it. and we wish to see you in a big scale and going not just there. I'll also connect you to Manipal. You definitely need to meet some people there. UDP is a good place. Let's get into Andhra, Vellore. You know, there is a market. There's a market. Absolutely. And as you said, 1%.
Yep, that's it. That's
1% is enough. Yeah, to get your, because you're a very high budget business. Right. And there is a market. There is a market still.
Always.
Right. So it depends on us. See, same BTEC computer science can study in VIT, or you can just go to a neighboring school. All right. You have a heart surgery in Apollo for, say, 8 lakhs, 10 lakhs. You also have it for 2 lakhs, 1 lakh. You also have a government hospital for free.
So there is a market. You have an OYO, right? It's the same.
Yeah. Yeah. So thanks all. It's our lunchtime. Yeah. Aman, thank you so much.
Great.
I really appreciate it. Yeah. We'll keep in touch and we'll invite you to the campus soon if everything is well. All right.
Yeah. All right.
Bless.
Yeah, thank you so much. Good.
Thanks, everyone. Take care. Yeah. All right, so...